Wednesday, the ladies' workshop, commencing 10:30 a.m. That's on this Wednesday, the second Wednesday of the month. And on the rotation, we're back to Zoom, studying the life of Joseph at 8 p.m. Some forward dates, Kirk session, remember you meet on Monday the 14th at 8 p.m. And the ladies' Bible study then will be on the 16th. And a reminder of that congregation committee later in the month, the 24th of March. Last week I highlighted some of the camps, and just to remind you that the CEF, that's for 9 to 11 year olds, beginning on the 30th of June, and in Hazlett School in Ardcliffe. If you're interested, please ask for further details. The older age group, year 9 to 11, also has been run not in Ardcliffe but in Kilkeel. And then they're also reminded the Faith Mission offer opportunities for discovery and adventure camp for the various age groups. So if you want any details and they're not available, do please ask. I did have this slide on from last week, but I think all of our Presbyterian heralds are gone. I was in the hall this morning and I didn't see any, so I think you have them all. Yep. Oh, there's one or two that Jennifer has. So if you haven't got, thank you to Jennifer for distributing them, and Jennifer has them this morning, so thank you for that. Those are all the announcements this morning. Later on, in our present session, there are some slides sent from PCI about Ukraine, and the moderator has launched an appeal, and there'll be opportunity over the next 3 weeks, if you wish, to bring the nations towards that. We'll go through the slides and mention a little more about that later on. Just heard a few days ago that some of the Christians in Ukraine were praying and reciting Psalm 33. And Psalm 33 on the screen and the New King James Version says this: "In thee, O Lord, do I put my trust. Let me never be ashamed. Deliver me in thy righteousness." They were looking to God as their refuge, their help, and their strength. Let's seek God's help upon us. Let us pray. Father, we come to worship, adore, and praise you. We come humbly before you, praying that we will sense your presence, know the touch of your Holy Spirit, and that, Lord, we will be richly blessed in this time of worship. We thank you for those who will lead worship, for the girls and the praise group. We thank you for each head bowed before you. And we pray, Lord, that it will be a blessed time for each one. And may we hear your voice. We ask this in the Savior's name. Amen. The opening praise is, "Come, people of the risen King, who rejoice to bring him praise."
Come all and tune your
Let's bow in prayer. Father, we come to you as the Church of Christ, recognizing that He is the sole King and Head of the Church, recognizing that indeed Christ purchased us through shedding His blood on the cross for us. And Lord, we come humbly and with gratitude before you, the Almighty God, the Maker of heaven and earth, the God who is faithful, the God who never forsakes His people. And we thank you for the words that we've read already from this psalmist. We thank you that we can put our trust in you, knowing that you will never let us be ashamed. We thank you that we can rejoice that your love and your faithfulness is unfailing. We come before you recognizing and confessing our faults and our shortcomings. We come confessing that we have failed you often, that, Lord, we have been indifferent to your word and your commands. Lord, we have been apathetic and lazy in spiritual matters. And Lord, we ask that you will forgive us. Give us a desire to seek you through your word and through prayer. And remind us in need that you want us to grow in our faith. Lord, all too often we are content simply to drift along. Give us a spiritual appetite, an appetite for the things that will help us to grow closer to Jesus and enable us to walk each day in your path. And we thank you indeed that you promise blessing for those who do that, for those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, promising that they will indeed be filled. We pause today to acknowledge your goodness and your love. We pause again today to reflect upon the fact that without Christ we are nothing. And we thank you and praise you for all that He has done for us. We thank you and praise you that Jesus gives us new life. And He can, through His Spirit, give us true satisfaction and joy. And so we come as thankful people, thankful that you indeed are interested in each aspect of our lives. Nothing is too small for us to bring to you, and nothing is too great for you to deal with. Help us to come consistently to you with all our problems, seeking your help, that we might know your blessing, that we might know your encouragement. We thank you for each head bowed before you. Lord, you know our individual lives. You know the things that concern us. You know the things that cause us anguish and pain and distress. And so we commit each one to you and ask, Lord, that you administer graciously to each one of us, that we might be able to acknowledge that your grace is always sufficient, that we might trust you more fully and live lives that are devoted entirely to you. Help us to love you with all our heart, our soul, our strength, our mind, and indeed to love our neighbor as ourselves. Lord, we pray that Christ will truly be on the throne. As we continue to look at the book of Acts today, we thank you that you have set before us the patterns of the early church. And Lord, help us as we would read today from your word to listen attentively. And Lord, maybe grasp the challenge to us. And help us not just simply to hear your voice, but to be obedient to your call. And help us to have that desire to shape our lives according to the teaching of Scripture. May Christ alone be exalted. May Christ alone be lifted high in this time of worship. And we pray all these things in and through the lovely name of Jesus, the one who loved us and gave himself for us. Amen. The girls are going to come and sing. And it's a lovely piece, You're Still God. And I was typing this out on Friday evening for the PowerPoint after listening to the news of all that was going on in Ukraine, and we can become very distressed and very annoyed about what is happening, the suffering of so many. And it was so timely to type these words out and to remember and reflect upon the fact that God is still God. No matter what is happening, He is still sovereign. So thank you to the girls. They're going to come and sing this piece.
Have been shaken.
reminding us that God does reign. He's still God despite everything we can't understand. We're going to read together from God's Word. If you want to follow in the Pew Bible, it's page 1094. We're going to read together the final verses of Acts chapter 2, the fellowship of the believers, from verse 42. This is the word of God. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and miraculous signs were done by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common, selling their possessions and goods. They gave to anyone as he had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Amen. We thank God for his truth. Good to have some children out again this morning. And I want to share briefly with you. Boys and girls, I'm sure you like sweets. Yep, most of you do. Some more than others. Well, I'll show you a picture of one on the screen that I like, and I happen to have in my pocket as well. Okay. Do you like those? Yeah. Good, good. Well, I have here in my pocket. And why do you like Rolo? What's in the middle of them? Tell you what, I'll eat one, I'll tell you. I like them as well because there's caramel in the middle. How many do you think I have left here? How many's left? Three? Nope. Less than three? There was two when the service started. Just one. There's one left. What should I do with this one? Oh, you're very wise. I should eat it. I thought you were going to say giving it to the organist for playing. I should eat it. That wouldn't be a bad idea. Or I could take it home and give it to someone else. The last one's very important, isn't it? It is. It's very important, the last one. And particularly Rolo's, because there's an advert in TV, and I'm sure you know what it says. But first of all, let me show you this. Now, that's a wee bit far away for you. Maybe you can read. You girls, you were sending Valentine cards, weren't you? Did you? Of course you did. Well, you will be soon. Any over here? No? Well, there's a wee rhyme there. You can read it out. What does it say? Roses are red. Violets are blue. What's the last wee bit? I see it, my last rule, though. Especially for you. You can use that the next time you're writing cards, girls, okay? And why does it say that? I've saved my last rule, though. Because the TV advert, what it says, there's a question. Do you love anyone enough to give them your last rule, though? Isn't that an amazing question? Do you love anyone enough to give them your last rule, though? Okay, so I don't know what. I think your advice would be good. I can't start giving it to children because there's not enough. Isn't that right? And because of COVID, I can't share it. Can't even give them to the organist. Or my wife might be jealous as well. That wouldn't do. That's a good idea. I could eat it. But that question, do you love anyone enough to give them your last rule? That advert's been on for a long time. And it's saying, rulers are so special. When you get through the packet, you go down and down and down to the last one. You've one left. You really want it yourself. Will you eat it or will you give it to someone? And you must think someone's very special if you give them your last rule. Well, we read there from Acts 2, and it talked about sharing. It wasn't talking about sharing rulers. It was talking about sharing possessions. And this is what we read. All the believers were together, had everything in common, selling possessions and goods. They gave to anyone as they had need. And the early church in Jerusalem, whenever someone had a need, it tells us that they sold their possessions so they could share, so they should give to them. They showed love in a very practical way. And if you watch the TV screens, there's a lot of bad news on, sadly, with Ukraine, a lot of suffering. But you also see great generosity, because some of the ones who are refugees are going to other parts of Ukraine. And I was watching last night, there was places where there was a whole lot of clothes and things left, so that the refugees could come. They left with very little, and they could pick up clothes and food and things for their children and for their family. And of course, across the border, in neighboring countries, they are seeking to do that as well. And as a congregation, we'll have the opportunity through the moderator's appeal to give to Ukraine, those who are suffering. But the early church was like that. They were thoughtful. They cared for one another. They shared with one another. And later on in chapter 4 tells us that as well, that they gave to those who had need, because some were well off, some were rich, some were poor, but they knew they were one in Christ. But then the question we might ask is, why were they so generous? Why did they share with others? Well, they knew that God was generous to them. They knew that they were saved because they trusted in Jesus. They knew that Jesus had died for them to be their Savior. And you see, they thought, God has done so much for us. He loves us so much. Jesus died on the cross to save us. Therefore, we should love one another. And you see, Jesus was asked about the greatest commandments. And he said, there's summed up, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, strength, and mind. And the second is likewise, love your neighbor as yourself. God wants us to love him, to serve him, and to worship him. And then he wants us to love each other. As we think about sharing, remember all that God has done for us in providing a Savior. So next time you have a packet of Rolos, and you get to the very last one, remember the advert, the question, do you love anyone enough to give them your last Rolo? Remember what God has done. He loved us enough to give his only Son to die for us. And he calls us to love others as he has loved us. And we can do that with God's help and God's strength. Let's pray for a moment. Father, we praise you for your great love, that you would send Jesus to be our Savior. Help us to accept your wonderful offer of salvation. We thank you that as you have loved us, you call us to love others. And we thank you as we read about the early church, they cared for one another, they loved one another. Help us also to care for others. Help us to remember those in need. And particularly this morning, we would be very conscious of boys and girls and children in the land of Ukraine who have lost all their possessions and their homes, and in some instances have lost family members and even parents. Lord, may you surround them with your love and help us as we have an opportunity in the weeks to come to be generous in giving to them. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. As we are gathered, Jesus is here. We'll sing this twice through, I think. Okay, twice through. As we are gathered, Jesus is here.
Thank you.
We come to pray for others, and we think particularly of the crisis in Ukraine that is dominating so much of our news. And there are a number of slides that are on the thing here, and it's just reminding you of some of the issues as Ukraine continues to be bombarded. And as it reminds you, a million or so people have been displaced, and that is a rough estimate. There's probably more. And this is some of the slides from PCI. I'll just read them to you. The moderator's lunch and appeal. The three agencies that he's working with are Christian Aid and Tear Fund and Hungarian Reformed Church Aid. That's the three groups that they will work with. The Hungarian Reformed Church Aid, it says, provide humanitarian aid to Ukraine as well as medical help and practical assistance to refugees who come into Hungary. So that is one group that they are working with. And also we have Tear Fund and Christian Aid. They're working there also in Hungary, Slovakia, and Moldova, as well as inside Ukraine. And there's a lot there. I'll not take time to go through all this, but it's reminding us we are to pray for the de-escalation of the conflict, pray for all affected, and pray for the large Christian community that God will preserve them, God will use them for his glory, and through them that they will indeed glorify God and be a witness for him. And then the last slide, pray for those who've been recently displaced, pray for aid agencies and governments, and of course for the partners, for Tear Fund, for Christian Aid, and the Hungarian Reformed Church Aid. So let's come to God and remember the situation. Let us pray. Father, it is with heavy hearts that we come and lift up before you the land of Ukraine. We have seen consistently over the last week so much suffering on our news bulletins. And Lord, we find it hard to comprehend the evil that has been inflicted upon that nation. We pray at this time that you would draw very near to all who are suffering. We pray for those who have become refugees, who have lost home and family, and on some occasions, everything they have. Lord, we pray that you be very real and very near to each one of them. We thank you for the partners of PCI that will seek to provide help in Moldova and Slovenia and Ukraine itself. We thank you for the Hungarian Reformed Church as well. And pray, Lord, your blessing upon every effort to meet the material needs of these dear people. But Lord, we know that not only is there great material need, but we know that the scars have been great also in a mental sense. And we do pray for healing of body and of mind. We pray for those who feel shattered and forgotten, who are so uncertain of their future. We lift up before you those in positions of authority within Ukraine. We thank you for the leadership of the president and pray for your protection for him and government officials. We thank you especially for the vibrant church in Ukraine, and we pray that you enable them to be faithful witnesses where you have placed them. Help them to show love and compassion and grace towards each one. And this morning we do pray particularly for Vladimir Putin. Lord, we know indeed that he's motivated by evil and a desire for power and influence. But we pray that you would draw near and that you would speak to him, that you would penetrate that heart even today. And Lord, we pray that you would reveal to him the consequences of his decisions and the evil that is being carried out in Ukraine in Russia's name. We pray, Lord, that you would indeed touch him and that, Lord, he will turn from this evil campaign and that this war would cease. Lord, we commit this difficult situation to you, and we thank you that we can pray, and we pray that you would help us to be faithful each day in praying for our brothers and sisters in that land, and help us to give sacrificially indeed to the various appeals. As we come before you, we also remember the needs locally, praying your blessing upon all who are unwell in our own congregation, all who are advanced in years and finding life particularly difficult. We pray that they would know your grace, your comfort, and your help. And we thank you that you are a faithful and a loving God. And we just pray that each one will be very conscious of your presence. We thank you for the ongoing work of Sunday School and GRID and BB, etc., the work amongst our young people. And pray, Lord, that you'd use it for your glory and for the furtherance of your kingdom, that early in life many will find Jesus as their Savior. We pray, too, for the different organizations as they meet in the incoming week, and just ask your blessing upon all, upon the PW, upon the work class, and upon the midweek as they meet. O Lord, in everything may Christ alone be exalted and glorified. We do remember our wider church again at this time, praying your blessing upon our moderator and asking that you would encourage him and strengthen him in all that he seeks to do. We pray too for our local congregations, especially those who are vacant at this time. And in your mercy and grace, we pray that soon you will guide and direct the one of your choice. And finally, for ourselves, we pray that you'd open our hearts to your truth as we would soon turn to your word. Give us understanding. And we pray this in the name of Christ, our Savior. Amen. Third praise on the screen, the church's one foundation is Jesus Christ, her Lord. Philip Yancey made this comment: all too often the church holds up a mirror reflecting the society around it rather than a window revealing a different way. All too often the church holds up a mirror reflecting the society around it rather than revealing, and a window revealing a different way. And that statement is all too accurate, because often the church is not distinct from society as it should be, but often takes on board the mindset and of the culture of the day. And when that happens, it becomes irrelevant and powerless. It may not provoke much opposition, but it will be ineffective. It will not be strong. It will not be healthy. We have read today the final verses in Acts chapter 2. We looked at the first 13 verses a few weeks back, the events of Pentecost. Then last week, we looked at the sermon of Peter, that Spirit-empowered sermon that God blessed, and through it, 3,000 turned to Christ and were baptized, indicating their entry into the church. Well, today we're going to focus on the lives of these 3,000, the early church, after their repentance. Because when we repent of our sin and trust Christ as Savior, it's not the end, it is to be the beginning. And it's so vital that we continue, and we continue in the path to grow and to develop spiritually, and that can be only done through fellowship with God's people. And what we have in these verses is a description of the church at its best, the fundamentals of a healthy church. And remember, as you read these verses in this church, this fledgling church, it is one that has no great buildings or facilities. It doesn't have a massive budget to spend. It doesn't have great programs. It doesn't have marketing and promoting strategy. All that stuff that is often prioritized. Yet what it did have was special. There was simplicity that made up their fellowship. Their witness and their ministry was set apart by divine power, so much so that the world took notice of it. And the church that we encounter here, this fledgling early church in Jerusalem, well, it is a united church, a Spirit-filled church, a compassionate, prayerful church, and it is marked by its devotion to the Bible and to prayer and to evangelistic zeal. But as we look at these characteristics, note we began reading in verse 42, they devoted themselves to, and then it lists several things they were devoted to. Some versions say they continued steadfastly. But whether it's continued steadfastly or the word devoted, it simply means they abandoned themselves to these things unselfishly. I want to point out four things. It's possible to list more, but four things that they were devoted to that indicates the marks and the fundamental marks of a healthy church. First of all, a healthy church is devoted to teaching of God's word. Verse 42, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. Do you see, what a church believes will determine how a church behaves. What a church believes will determine how a church will behave. And what you believe is important to your spiritual health. To truly be a Spirit-filled fellowship, it needs to be, first of all, a Scripture-fed fellowship. The newly established church continually devoted itself to the teaching of the apostles, it says. And it uses the imperfect tense. That means it was ongoing, recurring. It was their habitual activity over a period of time. So these new believers, it wasn't a temporary devotion. It wasn't short-lived. They continually devoted themselves to the teaching of the apostles. They had come to faith in Christ. Now they needed to be built up in that faith. They needed to be edified. They needed to be strengthened in order to be healthy believers. And it says they devoted themselves to the teaching. They had accept no substitute for the apostolic teaching. You see, the disciples, the apostles, were those who had seen the resurrected Lord, and they passed on the truth of the gospel. Jude 3 puts it this way, the faith that was once for all entrusted to the saints. And that teaching had authority. That teaching was not to be abandoned. And of course, Paul, when he wrote to the church in Galatia in the opening chapter, he condemned them for straying from the faith, from straying from the teaching of God's words. And he was indeed amazed that they so quickly departed from the truth. The early church was constant and consistent in seeking to know God's word in the scriptures they had. The New King James Version puts it this way, that they were consistent in teaching the doctrine. And you see, regular, consistent teaching of the Bible is what every Christian needs. The apostles' teaching is listed first here Because these devout Jews of the early church put priority on the teaching. They put priority on doctrine. They understood the religious system that they had been under, developed by the Pharisees and the scribes, had simply led them astray. And so they want to understand Jesus. They want to follow his ways. And so they give attention to what the apostles teach about Jesus. They continually abandon themselves to the explanation of Jesus' teaching. And you see, all who claim to be Christians should want to know, should want to understand, and then apply what God says in his word so that we can walk with Jesus in a worthy manner. We should be devoted to the teaching of God's words. And we have far more scriptures than the early church. We have the full canon of scripture. George Barna said this: the church is designed to be a teaching center. However, Christians don't act like Christians because they don't think like Christians, and they don't think like Christians because they don't understand their faith. And what he's really saying there, that man George Barna, is the church should teach the scripture, and Christians should live according to the guidance of scripture, but too many are not acting like Christians because they don't understand the scriptures. They're not thinking the Christian way because they have failed to study God's word as they should. And what here we see is that a healthy church is first of all a teaching church, a church where the scriptures are given priority, a church where the scriptures are valued, and where the Bible is taught accurately, where the Bible is taught consistently. A healthy church is devoted to teaching of the word of God. And a healthy church, secondly, is devoted to fellowship. Luke here says they were devoted. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship. And we must also build and develop a church that is devoted to fellowship. Here's the community component of a healthy church. And the term that Luke uses for fellowship in our text is much broader than our English word. Essentially, fellowship means joint participation, sharing something in common. It's a kind of partnership. And that's how it's used in Scripture, that word. In Philippians 2:1, the term is used of common sharing of the Holy Spirit. Philippians 3:10 and 1 Peter 4:13, sharing of the suffering of Christ as his body. And finally, Galatians 2:9, sharing together in ministry. The Greek word is koinonia. It refers to intimate spiritual connection. It's a deep bond that's stronger than mere affinity or life stage or race or class or anything else we have in common. And you see, very simply, Christianity is relational. We begin by coming into a relationship with God through trusting in Christ as Savior. We have a relationship with the Father, with the Son, with the Holy Spirit. And then we are to have a relationship then with our brothers and sisters in Christ. And fellowship expresses what we share together, what we give as well as what we receive. And our fellowship together is seen in the fact that often in the New Testament we have that phrase, one another. It comes up negatively, it comes up in a positive sense. Negatively, don't challenge one another, don't complain against one another, don't devour one another, or don't envy or judge one another. There's those negative instances. And then there are many positive. Accept one another, admonish one another, bear one another's burdens, care for one another, pray for one another. Be at peace with one another. Have the same mind towards one another. Serve one another and so forth. We're to be tender-hearted towards each other. The church, you see, is not merely a group of loosely connected individuals, but it is a body of believers who share a common life in Jesus Christ. Of course, Paul talks about when one part suffers, all suffers. That is why we should feel great pain that our brothers and sisters in Ukraine are suffering so terribly at this time. As they suffer, we too suffer. One writer said this about the church in Acts 2. It said they were like new weds who could not get enough of each other. Now think about that. The implication is that when we're newly wed, we want to spend time together, we can't get enough of each other. And the implication also would be that that would dim over a period of time. But here they are, newly converted, coming together. And like new weds, they want to spend time together. They can't get enough of each other. And you see, note what it says in verse 46. Every day, Every day they continued to meet in the temple courts. They broke bread together in their homes, ate together with glad and sincere hearts. It wasn't occasional. It was every day. These believers were not independent. They were interdependent. You see, the early church knew the importance of staying in fellowship with brothers and sisters in Christ. They realized that there are strengths and there's a bond that is deeper than blood itself. And we in the church need, of course, to understand that we need to come together corporately. We need to come together to worship. We need to come together to pray. We need to come together to study God's word if we're to be vibrant and strong and healthy, if we are to grow. And when you know the early church, this group, they were from various backgrounds and various places. There was a great diversity among them, but they were members of one body. Therefore, they were devoted to fellowship. And no one in this spirit-led community at this time was asking the selfish question, who is the greatest? There was no hint of envy, jealousy, or rivalry, division, or quarreling at all. The fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, etc., was being manifested in this church. Now, in the book of Hebrews, you read that we should not neglect the gathering together of the saints. By the time that book was written, which was later, formalism had already crept into the church, and there were some who weren't bothering to meet together. But here in the book of Acts, we see people gathering together, not on a weekly basis, on a daily basis. They cherished this fellowship. They thrived in it. They looked forward to meeting together around God's word and growing together. You see, that's the challenge for believers, the value, to prioritize opportunities to come together to read God's word, to come together to pray, to come together to enjoy fellowship, to come together to grow as God's people. A healthy church is devoted to fellowship. But the third element that is evident is that a healthy church is devoted to prayer. Something we stressed before when we considered the opening chapter. We noted how Luke was emphasizing the commitment of that group to pray, and we noted how there was great prayer first before Pentecost, the prayer and then the outpouring of God's Spirit. Acts 1:14, they all joined together constantly in prayer. The early church simply stated was a praying church. And someone said this, we move forward in the church of God on our knees. We move forward, we advance on our knees. It was that way in the past, it is that way today, it will always be that way. And a church that does not pray will have no power, because a prayerless church will be a powerless church. And as we will, God willing, look at more of the book of Acts in the coming weeks and months, we will see how consistently and that these people prayed. When someone was in trouble, they prayed. That was true in Acts 4, next chapter 12. When there was a particular need, they prayed. When they were afraid, uncertain, not knowing what way to turn, they prayed. They prayed consistently. Of course, Jesus had left them in a state of total dependence. He gave them the Great Commission, and he told them to do nothing except pray until the Holy Spirit came. And back in chapter 1, we noticed for those 10 days, they devoted themselves to praying. Then Peter stood up. He preached. Some suggest it took about 10 minutes for Peter to preach this great sermon at Pentecost. And 3,000 came to faith. 3,000 precious souls were saved. Pray for 10 days. Preach for 10 minutes. 3,000 are converted. Well, this particular commentator points out that often that's not the balance we have today. Whereas the early church prayed for 10 days and Peter preached for 10 minutes, we almost do the opposite. We spend so little time in praying and far more in activity. You see, a healthy church is a teaching church where God's word is taught and valued and prioritized. A healthy church is a loving church where fellowship is important. And a healthy church is a church where God's people value prayer. It is a church where they are devoted to prayer. So the church we see here in Jerusalem, this model church, if you like, is a teaching church, a loving church, a praying church, and finally, it is a giving church. A healthy church is a giving church. Note verses 44 and 45. All the believers were together and had everything in common. Selling their possessions and goods, they gave to anyone as he had need. They shared their material goods with one another. Now some have suggested, is this not socialism or communism? Not so. Because communism says, what's yours is mine. These Christians said, what's mine is yours. What's mine is yours. And you see, under communism, sharing is compulsory, but there's nothing compulsory here. They did it all voluntarily. They did it all with a loving, gracious heart. They were ready to share their possessions. They were ready to share their goods with any who had need. You see, it wasn't the law of the early church. It was simply a demonstration of their entire consecration to God. Because the Bible teaches the possessions of the Christian should be consecrated to God. All that we have, materially speaking, is God's, and to be used for God. Now, these particular people who came to faith, many of them had been accustomed to giving a tenth under the law. But now, under the gospel dispensation, filled with the Spirit, motivated by the love of Christ, they gave anything and everything for Christ. They wished to share with others who had little. They wish to fill the treasure of the church that funds might be available to continue out to continue the great task of making Jesus known in Judea, Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the world. The many commentators have pointed out that the verb for selling in Greek is the imperfect tense. Verse 43, it says, selling their possessions. Well, it's in the imperfect tense. What does that mean? Well, it means that there wasn't one big seal upon their conversion. Rather, individuals sold possessions of their their property as needs in the community would surface. So it literally says they kept on selling what they had and distributed it. As James Boyce points out, they were generous because they had learned generosity from God. And that's what grace teaches us. We see clearly in God's unconditional election for his people. He chose us for himself through faith alone. He suffered. And Christ gave up his life for us who were undeserving. You see, God didn't choose the good. He chose the bad. He didn't die for the righteous. The Bible says he died for the unrighteous. And the early church was so conscious of what God had done for them. And they were simply stating and thinking, if God loved us so much to give Jesus to die for us, should we not love one another? Of course, we are called to be generous. We are called to be a giving church, and that should be our default position. John Stott writes, it is part of the responsibility of spirit-filled believers to alleviate need and to abolish destitution in the new community of Jesus. But note, they were not only meeting each other's physical needs, they were encouraging one another in the Christian life. Verse 46 says this, every day they continued to meet together in temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts. And then in the final verse of chapter 2, we're told this behavior was noticed. It was noticed and the church began to grow. Men and women were coming to faith in Christ on a daily basis. And from all over the city, people were being drawn to this spirit-filled fellowship. You see, when the church is what God wants it to be, it will be noticed. When the church is what God wants it to be, it will be attractive. Others will be drawn to it. But of course, we ask the question, what are the challenges for us in 2022? Well, we should remember the early church shook the world. It started so in the upper room, here, a small number. Then in Pentecost, it exploded and it went on to shake the world. The early church shook the world, and the church can today if they follow its pattern. United, spirit-led, generous, devoted to doctrine and prayer. If we follow this pattern, if we live like this, it will truly shake our community and our world. And note in verses 44 to 46, tells us they were together, they met together, they ate together, they learned together, they shared together, they prayed together. They were a true community, a community of people who had been changed by trusting in Christ, devoted to God, devoted to teaching, devoted to prayer, devoted to one another. Let's pray that God will enable us to reflect something of the spirit of these believers and use us for His glory. Amen. Let's pray for a moment. Father, we thank You for the early church, for the vibrant, strong community of believers that we read about at the end of Acts chapter 2. And Lord, help us to note the challenge. They were devoted to the apostles' teaching. Give us a hunger and thirst for Your word. Give us a desire to be a praying people, to be a caring people, to be a united people. Lord, help us indeed to see the needs of others, and as we have opportunity, to seek to alleviate their suffering. Lord, we pray that we would reflect Jesus more, and we pray that You'd forgive us when we simply reflect the society around us. Help us instead to be a window revealing a different way, a way that brings true fulfillment, true joy, and true satisfaction. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Brother, sister, let me serve you. Let me be as Christ to you. Is a closing praise. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be our portion and strength this day and forevermore. Amen.